This is a piezo disc. It's a bit of copper and ceramic that can turn vibrations into electricity. And with a few simple elements, you can turn the piezo disc into a contact microphone that can turn that electrical current into audio signals like this. So a contact microphone works by picking up vibrations off the surface of whatever object you attach it to. And that's where the name comes from. It has to be in contact with the object you want to record. And this allows you to hear sounds and frequencies that your typical microphones don't pick up. And they also have a really cool advantage of isolating whatever sounds you're trying to record. So for instance, since they're only picking up the object that they're touching, they're not going to hear all of the ambient sounds in whatever environment you're recording in. What's cool is that you can build a simple contact microphone using parts that cost less than $10. So let's do just that. Let's get started. All the parts that you need to build a contact microphone can be easily found online. If you're watching this on Patreon, I have a document in the description below with links to all the supplies that you're going to see in this video. So the first thing that you're going to buy is a piezo disc. And now these come in a variety of different sizes. The larger ones tend to pick up a wider frequency range, and the smaller ones are great at getting into tighter spaces that the large ones just won't fit in. One quick note before we continue.
In England, we say solder.
In America, we say solder.
Now, some of these discs will come with the wires already soldered on, and that's helpful if you don't feel like soldering them onto the disc itself, but you're going to want to solder a bit more wire onto those wires anyway in order to make that length of cable usable. Which brings us to the next supply that you'll need to buy, wire. Now, wire comes in all kinds of different types, but my current favorite is this single core shielded wire. It's super flexible and it's lightweight, which is perfect for contact microphones. And finally, you need a way to get the audio from your contact microphone into your amplifier or recording device. And just like with most of the other supplies, there are a lot of options depending on your preference. Now, I'm going to show you how to solder up connectors like these. This is a male instrument jack and a female instrument jack. And you can decide which one works best for your needs. The only tool that you'll need for these is a basic soldering iron. And it's also helpful if you happen to have a hot glue gun and or some electrical tape. All right, so let's make a basic contact microphone. Now, if you're new to soldering, this is a perfect project to start with because it only requires 4 very simple solder points. So when we look at the back of a piezo disc, the center ceramic part is positive signal, and the outside copper part is ground. Now, if we look at the female instrument jack, the tip is going to be positive, and the sleeve is going to be ground. Now, these wiring principles also work if you want to use a male instrument jack. The tip is going to be positive, and the sleeve is going to be ground. So what we need to do is connect the ground to ground, and the positive to positive. So the first step is to strip away a bit of the casing from our wire. And then we're going to twist a bit of this shielding in the cable to use as a wire itself. And we do that same thing on both ends. Now, to prepare your wires, you want to melt a bit of solder into them, which will give you a better connection when you finally solder them onto the elements. Now, to prepare the piezo disc, you just melt a small dot of solder onto both the ceramic and the copper parts of the disc. And when connecting your wire, it's best to have as little wire exposed as possible. This will help make sure that you pick up as little electronic interference as possible. So it's helpful practice to solder the wire that's in red casing to your positive ceramic, and then the exposed shielded wire to ground, which is copper. So now when it's time to solder the wires onto your audio connector, it's easier to know that the red wire is your positive, and the shielded copper wire that you twisted is going to be the ground. And when everything's connected up, you have your first contact microphone. Congratulations! put it on different items, and see how they sound when you tap them, bang them with drumsticks, but you might notice one thing. These basic contact microphones tend to be a little noisy. So the good thing is that it's really easy to upgrade this basic contact microphone model into one that's a lot better at blocking out this electronic interference. It's worth talking about the two main ways you can wire a contact mic. So far, we've used a single piezo disc with a standard instrument cable, and that's called an unbalanced connection. It's simple, it works with most amps, pedals, and recorders. The downside is if you use a longer cable, you can pick up a lot more noise. The other option is to wire a dual piezo setup with an XLR connector like you see here. This gives you a balanced signal, which can travel a lot longer without picking up hum or any kind of electrical interference. Now there's a lot more electrical details about impedance to consider, but that's for another video.
So let's talk about the supplies that you need to make a balanced contact mic. This type of wire is very similar to the unbalanced microphone that we just made, except instead of having one red wire in the middle, it's got two wires, so it is called dual core shielded cable.
You don't always have to buy this. If you happen to have old microphone cables that you're willing to part with, you can always reuse them by cutting the ends off. You can always leave the end with the male plug, and it'll save you a step of having to solder it onto the cable yourself.
So the next part we're going to need, again, is piezo discs. So unlike the unbalanced piezo mic, this balanced version will use two piezo discs.
This allows you to wire them up in a way that properly uses all three of the pins that are on an XLR plug.
Which brings us to the third item that we'll need, which is an XLR plug. Now there are high-end XLR plugs, but if you're just getting started, these very basic models will work just fine.
One other connector you can consider for a balanced contact mic are these TRS plugs. In order to keep this video from getting too in the weeds, I'll save these for a later episode.
Now that we have our supplies, let's make a balanced contact mic. So just like with the single core wire, the dual core has this shield that carries away electronic interference to ground. And just like with the unbalanced mic, we're going to twist this cable into its own wire. We're left with this string material, which we can just cut off. And now we're left with three wires. We want to go ahead and strip some of the case off of these two wires sticking out. This is the end that we'll attach to our XLR plug. The end that attaches to the piezo mics is treated a little bit different. Instead of twisting that copper shielding into one wire, we're going to separate it into two wires, like you see here. And you want to leave these wires a little bit longer so that they can connect to the piezo discs correctly. You prepare them just like we did with the balanced microphone by adding some solder onto them. This is called tinning, by the way. So again, you'll want to prepare your piezo discs with a bit of solder on both the ceramic and copper. And then before soldering the cables onto them, you can do a bit of eyeballing just to trim any extra length off of the cables to keep them as short as you can. And now you connect the wires in the way that I have them diagrammed. And in this diagram, you might have noticed, but the shielding part that we twisted into a cable is colored green. Red wire goes to the ceramic positive on one piezo. One of the copper shielded wires goes onto the ground of that same piezo. Then the blue wire will be connected to the ground on the other piezo. And we need to be careful with this next part because this shielded cable needs to connect to the center positive. But it can't touch the copper or we will get a short. So in order to protect it from shorting out, you can put a bit of electrical tape underneath the wire, or a barrier of hot glue or duct tape will also work. And now we can solder that wire safely to the center of the disc without it touching the copper ring. Now if the wires on the backs of these two piezo discs touch each other, they'll short out the signal and either make a lot of crackling or cut the signal out completely. So I like to cover them with electrical tape before I start playing around with them. It's a bit sloppy at first, but then I cut around the edges to make it as neat as possible. And the next thing I'll do is also protect the wires themselves with a bit of tape. So this is a very basic way of protecting the piezo discs and wires. There are upgraded ways to do this, which I'll show you in an upcoming episode. You can keep the discs separated when you use them like this, or you can glue them together with some hot glue and create a double-sided contact microphone. All right, so let's talk about the XLR connector here. We'll start by separating it from its boot and then pushing the connectors out from the inside. There's this plastic piece inside that helps with cable stress relief, so we'll take that out. And finally, we have the pins. Now, before you get started soldering the wire to the pins, you need to put the boot onto the wire. Otherwise, you'll have to start all over again in order to get it on. Now, you can put this plastic part on now. Since it has a space on the side, you can always feed it on later. So again, using the diagram as reference, if we orient the XLR pins in a way that this tab is on top, you'll see that the rightmost pin is going to be ground. The bottom pin is going to be negative, and the left pin is going to be positive. You'll wire the XLR pins, making sure that the connections from the piezo discs are being connected to the right pins on the XLR connectors. When you reassemble this XLR case, you'll notice that each of the pieces on the inside have tabs on them that correspond with the slots on the case. If you didn't know that, you would go crazy trying to fit everything back together. So just be aware of where those are, and everything should slide in nicely. So now you attach the boot back onto the XLR, and you should be all set.
So keep in mind that even though there are two discs for this type of contact microphone, their signals sum into one mono signal, so it's not a stereo microphone. Building one of those will come in a later episode.
Now you can plug an XLR cable directly into most audio interfaces, but if you want to plug it into an amp, you can always use one of these adapters.
There's all kinds of different adapters that will turn an XLR signal into an instrument jack, but for this very basic use, the standard model is all you need.
So in addition to a balanced mic being less noisy than an unbalanced mic, it also provides a stronger signal with a lot more volume. You'll notice in order to match the volume between these two, I have to turn up the unbalanced microphone quite a bit and actually turn down the balanced mic. And there's still quite a bit of difference that you can hear in the volume levels.
And there you go. That's really all you need to know in order to get started with the basics of contact microphones. But this is just the beginning. Here you can see some of the contact microphones that I've built to use in my own projects. Now most of these are waterproofed. Some of them have magnets inside so they stick to metal. Some have suction cups so they can stick to smooth surfaces. Now this one has these bendable arms built into it so it can hold on to surfaces that other microphones can't stick to. I've also added contact microphones into the fingertips of gloves, and created some that have holes that go through the body in order to feed strings or chains through for some really interesting sound effect results. Beyond creating custom housing for contact microphones, you can also build them directly into items like this soup can, or this little jangle box, or even found items like this broken space heater. In the following episodes, I'm going to show you how to supercharge the signal of your contact microphone, which really takes its signal to the next level. And to do that, we'll use built-in preamp circuits. I'll show you where to buy pre-made contact microphones and discuss the different types that are available to buy. And I'll also show you some interesting ways to use them both in the field and in the studio. So if you're interested in tapping into and recording the sounds that are hidden all around you, check out the rest of the series on Patreon. I'll see you there.